Okay, Baba O'Reilly by The Who. So this is probably, well, I mean, it is one of the Who's biggest songs. Already I'm stumbling here. And yeah, I mean, I've heard this song, but I've never delved into the lyrics. And I've never actually, like, read the lyrics or anything. I've just heard the song so many times on, like, rock radio stations around my town and all that kind of stuff. So I'm just gonna, finally get into this. Somebody requested it, and I thought, why not do it? Why not? So let's get into it, and I don't know if I pause halfway through or what, but we'll talk about it after. Hopefully, I don't know if this will get copyrighted. We'll see, and maybe no one will ever see this anyway. But anyway, let's just go. Iconic intro.
Yeah.
Jeez. All right. I didn't even feel like 5 minutes there. So yeah, The Who and Baba O'Reilly. Just listening to the song like on its own, I don't think I've actually ever like, you know, fished out the song, I guess you could say. Like I've never actually like, I guess, you know, actually searched for it and listened to it on my own or something, because I've just always heard it on the radio and stuff. Like I've heard it enough. And but yeah, it's a very different experience just like listening to it just like right here, right now, by myself. And yeah, it's just, I mean, I get a better appreciation for like Roger Daltrey's vocals, of how like powerful he sounds. And yeah, it's just, and the musical instruments on their own, with especially in the intro and then the outro as well, and the instrumentals, and this, the background music all together, is just a lot better appreciation for everything in the song. And yeah, so I guess I'll just talk about some of the stuff here with the bio on the song from genius.com. So it says, Baba O'Reilly by The Who was initially part of an idea later thrown aside of a follow-up rock opera to Tommy, Lifehouse. Pete TOWNZ-END? My goodness, I know who he is, but I don't know how to say his name right now. Wrote it after the experience at Woodstock. It did well as a single in Europe, but appeared only on the album in the US and in the UK. The name of the song is a combination of Mir Baba, about whom and his influence on him, Pete elaborates in a Rolling Stone article. An Indian guru that kept silent from 1935 until his death in 1969, who inspired TOWNZ-END's spiritually and Terry Riley, a musician and classical composer that also inspired him. I don't know why I'm having trouble. I can't even talk right now. It's very late. I don't know. I should go to bed, but I'm just doing this. Saying Pete TOWNZ-END. I mean, that's how it's spelled, but I feel like it's said a different way. Anyway, it says the song is sometimes mistakenly called Teenage Wasteland due to the repeating phrase. So, yeah, let me go up here in the annotation realm. So it says with the intro, obviously this intro is very iconic. I think it said that at the start. I mean, you've heard this intro probably, I mean, everybody's probably heard this intro long. I mean, you might not know the song, but you know the friggin' intro. So it says, the very VC-S3 organ as a synthesizer led an unusual instrumental opening. It is also used to establish a song's percussion rhythm, one of the earliest of such uses. It says, its latter part reminds many of the Bachman-Turner overdrive structure of the 1974 hit You Ain't Seen Nothing Yet, among other similarities. I didn't think about that. I know what You Ain't Seen Nothing Yet is, but I didn't think about that when I heard that part. But anyway, so it says, with the first verse from Roger Daltrey, the song was meant to be the opening for The Who's next rock opera, Lifehouse. It never materialized, so we have a story opening on which one can build his or her own story. So again, about how this was going to be the next rock opera, but it didn't turn out. So we go on. Out here in the fields, I fight for my meals. I get my back into my living. So it says he used to be a farmer and would battle against the elements to get food on the table. So, yeah, and then we go on. 6 years after wholeheartedly rejecting an apparently preconceived fate on my generation, Pete TOWNZ-END endorses the more basic traditional values, elevating the value of working the land. He would do so again on Now I'm a Farmer. So then we go on to the next annotation. There's so many annotations here just because the song is so iconic, probably. So it says, I don't need a fight to prove I'm right. I don't need to be forgiven. Yeah, 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 yeah. So it says these two lines about living in a society. We live in a society that doesn't take your personal values seriously and only judges you based on their preconceived ideas. Baba O'Reilly is proudly reactionary and independent. These lines indicate the power of psychological freedom from conventional ideas about right and wrong. So then we move on to the interlude. So it says, this is a great time to check out John Entwistle's excellent bass guitar work. So again, John Entwistle, this whole band was just, I mean, I've read articles before that John Entwistle kind of got forgotten a little bit in the band just because of, the sheer greatness of the other members of, like Pete TOWNZ-END, one of the greatest guitarists, even though I feel like I can't say his name right. Obviously Keith Moon on drums, one of the greatest drummers ever. I mean, next to like Friggin' John Bonham, I can't think right now. But yeah, I mean, and then all obviously Roger Daltrey on lyrics, or on lyrics, on vocals. His voice is just great as well. I mean, this whole band is just full of like great musicians. I mean, it's just nuts. So then we go on to the bridge, which is Pete Townshend. It says in the late 1960s, Pete started following the writings of Meher, I don't know how you say his name, Baba, again, an Indian spiritual guru. Whom he follows to this date. So again, he talks about him, but yeah, so obviously that was a influence for him. And then we go on, it says, don't cry, don't raise your eye. So the two line middle eight part entails a kid trying to convince an elder that the youth movement isn't all bad. It's also a reference to Altschuler's idea of interpolation. So yeah, and then we go on, and then here's a line, it's only Teenage Wasteland, which is line that many people know of the song, and they think that it, like it said, like people mistakenly think that's the name of the song. So it says the main repetitive phrase that became the alternate title. Unlike many interpreters, this is not an anti-Vietnam War protest, not a follow-up to My Generation and Townshend general social justice messages. It is the referral for their family place of origin. Therefore, it follows an exodus. Moving south, presumably to London. The drums really start getting wild here. A typical drum tab sheet is dull to read. Not so for Keith Moon's drumming. And I just want to make sure that stays there. Oh, so yeah, again, the drumming gets really nuts here, which is always a good sign to hear what Keith Moon can do. I mean, like I said, one of the greatest drummers ever. It's just, I always like to hear his drumming since I've heard so much of The Who just from, like I said, rock radio stations. So it says, in the second verse again, Sally, take my hand, we'll travel south across the land. Baba O'Reilly was written as the opening of a rock opera called Lifehouse, which was never completed again. Put out the fire and don't look past my shoulder. The warning lies in the advice not to look over her shoulder in the book of Genesis. Lot tells his wife not to look over her shoulder as they face, or as they flee the sin-filled cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. She ignores the advice and is turned into a pillar of salt. So it says, yeah, so there's some, you know, stuff, another biblical images. And again, we go on to the Exodus is here. So it says another biblical image presented by the lyricist. The farmer's departure from their land is equated to the departure of the Israelites from Egypt. An Exodus, which was from slavery to freedom, a significant enough event to warrant writing a whole Old Testament book. Then we go on, let's get together before we get much older. So in the lighthouse where the newcomers will find their peace and harmony and deeper connection with their own God. When the song came out in 1971, Get Together was commonly associated with hippies and the broader peace movement, thanks to the Youngblood song Get Together. And also it says the song is about wanting to escape from growing up, as shown in this line. They want to do everything before they grow up and lose their ability to see things clearly. My goodness, I bit my tongue earlier. It's just hurting like a bugger. So there we go on with the chorus. Teenage Wasteland. It's only Teenage Wasteland. Teenage Wasteland. Oh, yeah. So it says again, mistaken by many as the name of the song. It was the early working title for the song, and it lasted much longer. The expanded can be found in Pete Townshend's compilations. So yeah, and also somebody said, restating this, they said it wasn't getting wasted off the booze. It was people of my generation talking about saving the planet and doing nothing about it. It was wasted life. So that's what Pete Townshend said of Baba O'Reilly and how he wrote it. Again, he was a great songwriter as well. I just want to say that again. So it says Teenage Wasteland, and then it goes on, they're all wasted. And so it says Pete Townshend has explained that this line was intended as a comment on wasted lives, not getting wasted. Pete Townshend, the idea is not a critique of the teenagers, rather the place they came from in reality or virtually. So then there's that. And then again, it ends with the instrumental. And I feel like I've been talking forever here. So it says the ending, the coda, the ending instrumental piece dominated by a viola, which was drummer Keith Moon's idea. In the recording, the viola player was Dave Arbus of the East of Eden rock group. In concerts, the band used harmonica by Roger Daltrey instead of viola. And so yeah, that's all the annotations. My goodness. There's a lot of views on this page for the song. I mean, everyone, like the people that commented on this page, everyone just says they love the song. So just looking at the track info written by Pete Townshend, he was on guitar as well, John Entwistle on bass, mixing by Glenn Johns, recorder by Glenn Johns, drums Keith Moon, violin Dave Arbus, vocals Roger Daltrey and Pete Townshend, and piano by Pete, released in November of 1971. So yeah, this is all such a iconic song. I mean, you just can't really put into words how like big the song was, I mean, and how much it's remembered, and I mean, still listened to. I mean, it's just such, it probably will never die. I don't know, I can't say enough about this, where it's like, the song is huge. And yeah, I wanted to get to it here, and see what it's actually all about. And so yeah, this is pretty eye-opening, you know, and just makes me appreciate The Who even more, and just the genius of all four members. And unfortunately, two of them are gone, but I mean, it was the 70s, and they're pretty old now, but at least Roger and Pete are still around. And yeah, so I guess that's it. I'll talk to you guys soon. Thanks for watching. Thanks for liking and subscribing and commenting and all that stuff. It's all well appreciated. And again, I'll talk to you soon. And yeah, have a good one wherever you are. And thanks.